I think that this is going to be an interesting sequence of presentations. I'm going to talk a little bit about virtual reality research. I'm going to try to do justice to Tony Simon's research. And then Matt will talk about Minecraft and its incredible potential for educational opportunities for all children, including children with developmental disorders. So, you know, video games are intuitively appealing. There's all sorts of packaging for them right now, for both adults and children. But basically, in order for them to really be targeted, for video games or virtual reality to be targeted, we really have to understand something about why learning differences occur across children, across adults. And learning differences really occur most broadly because neural networks of the brain are perceiving or processing information differently, and that difference is impeding learning in some way. So here at the Mind Institute, we're really well positioned to really try to do some advanced work with gaming and virtual reality, because much of the research here is about trying to understand what those neural mechanisms are and precisely what the learning impediments are for children with neurodevelopmental disorders. One thing we understand about brain development and learning for all people is that it's an interaction between the information the brain's receiving and sort of the genetic predisposition towards cognitive development over time that really has the biggest impact. And one thing to keep in mind, we often hear about plasticity in the preschool period. One of the things that we really understand is that between 5 and 20 years, some of the most important plasticity is undergoing change, or the brain is maturing. And so that's an important window. So most of what we're going to be talking about today is that window, that 5 to 20 year window, and of course it goes beyond 20 years, where we can really continue to work with children with developmental disorders and really try to target the problems that they're having in learning. And we know that if we do that correctly, we have every opportunity for actually affecting brain growth. So that's one of the little bits of background for today's talk. These, you know, video games and virtual reality can provide rewarding experiences, and they can provide a lot of experience over time. And that's really the value of them. If you can figure out what kind of information to deliver, you can deliver it in a way that children will utilize. And so that's one of the great values of video games and virtual reality. They are appealing. We like to play these games as adults and children. So if we can figure out how to modify them, they're an easier access and for kids, and kids will do it over time, repeatedly. And so when we're talking about brain experience, what we need to do is come up with interventions that children will engage in a lot over time, and that's one of the beauties of video games, potentially. Some video games work for some types of problems, and not all games and methods work. So that's one of the messages today. There's a lot of games out there. There's a lot of things being rushed to market. Most of them don't have adequate evidence. Part of what today's talk is to show you the kind of evidence and the length, how much time and effort it takes to generate the evidence that some of these methods are really going to work. They need really extensive evidence. And what we really need to do is you need to identify the problem and then build the game around the problem, not just take a game and use it and hope that it's going to work. And so much of what we're going to show you is identifying a problem, developing a method, and then using that to try to help kids. So the outline is we're going to talk about virtual reality, which isn't video gaming, and I'll describe that in a second. Then, unfortunately, as Dr. Abaduda said, Tony Simon couldn't be here. We're going to show you a video of his work, and then I'm going to try to expound on it, because the video only briefly describes what he does. He provided us with some slides, and I can sort of fill in the gaps for that. And then Matt's going to talk about writing and Minecraft. All these kinds of things take lots of people doing lots of work over a long period of time. In terms of the next few minutes, I'm going to be talking about two methods that have been developed, one by Bill Gerald and one by Gwanga Kim, because they were the computer engineers that were working with us at the time, among a whole group of other people. You can see Matt is over here. He's part of the group as well. So one of the problems for children with autism involves being able to adopt a common frame of reference with other people. And one of the ways that we adopt a common frame of reference, particularly early in life, but throughout life, is monitoring where other people are looking. And so right now, I'm trying to engage and joint attention with you. I'm trying to get you to pay attention to the topics that I'm interested in. But I'm also trying to monitor whether or not you're interested. And if I see you flagging, I'll do something. I'll jump up and down and try to get you to be more interested again. So one of the things that goes on with children with autism is their learning is affected by the fact that they're not monitoring the eye gaze of people or coordinating their attention with other people. So one of the things that we wanted to do here was start to study that and see if virtual reality methods could be useful in affecting how well children with autism can pay attention to gaze, use gaze in a way that helps them learn or helps them communicate with other people. And the first method that we developed was this is for children with autism that are in general education classes. I think you know that now that there are many more children with autism, but there are also many more children affected by autism who have the intellectual wherewithal to be in regular education classrooms. In fact, about 68% in our recent epidemiology suggests that 68% of children with autism in the second grade have IQs that would allow them to do at least part-time, if not most of their time, in regular education classrooms. So we wanted to think about what could be a useful, what's going on for these kids that's problematic, and how can we help them in the classroom. So we decided to study public speaking, because there was enough information to indicate that one thing that these higher functioning or bright children with autism don't do is engage in public speaking in the classroom. They don't do book reports well, they don't talk with others very well, so we wanted to understand that. So we used virtual reality. Virtual reality is, at that time, and still is, you wear a headset, and the headset can provide the computer with information about where you're looking, because the headset monitors the degree to which you're moving your eyes and head up and down, left and right, and also rolling. And by giving the computer that information, you can actually interact with the computer when you follow different things on the computer. And we had a couple, what we wanted to do is have children with autism answer questions while talking to all these avatars. We wanted to see if that was a problem for them. And we also wanted to see whether talking to non-social avatars, these marbles, was going to be easier for the children with autism. And then in order to try to make it easier for the children with autism, we had them talk to the avatars, but the avatars would start to fade away, and they had to make eye contact with the avatars in order to make them solid again. So we thought we'd try to remind them to look and see whether that increased their ability to make eye contact and look at people while talking. And again, these headsets are, this is very old-fashioned now. When you get a headset now, it looks much more space-age. This is only 5 years ago that we were using headsets like this. They had little monitors in there. And again, it works by this little gyroscope up here tracking the head position of the child. And so this is what it looks like when the child was actually engaged in the task. And this is the fade condition. So the child's looking to their left, and they're looking directly at each target. And when they look basically between the eyes, the target will light back up. So this is the fade condition. All the time, though, they're talking. So they're doing something while they're doing this. So it's trying to do two things at once. And I'm sure many of you have probably done some public speaking, and it's a little bit hard because you're trying to focus on other people and monitor them and talk at the same time. So this is what the paradigm looked like. We had a group of 37 children affected by autism and some children that weren't. And we really had them just look around at first and then answer questions when the targets weren't fading. and then we had them answer questions when the targets were fading. And we really wanted to look at how often did they look at the peers. And what we found was something very interesting. We found that, you know, typical children, or typical or children without autism, I should say, would often look at this center target, but they'd also scan over here and to the other side. Their ability to perceive the social world was broad, and they would focus on each one. We're going to come back to that when we talk about Tony Simon's work in a few minutes. That span of apprehension, or span of attention, social attention, was very broad, and they'd make a lot of eye contact with these kids. This character over here and the one over here on the extreme, they didn't do very well with. But the children with autism dropped off right away. They really paid a lot of attention to the central character, but not to the others at all, or not at all, but less. When we looked at the marbles, though, we didn't see much of a difference between the groups at all. And so this was really a social effect. It was looking at the avatars and talking at the same time. They were just less capable of doing that. Not incapable, just less capable of doing it. But the thing that was really interesting for us is when we looked at learning problems measured by parent report, and this is an achievement test of math and an achievement test of reading, we found some very interesting things. The IQ of the child was related to the learning problems. The amount of inattention was related to the learning problems, but the degree to which children with autism showed individual differences in that ability to track those targets was also related to their learning problems. Children who didn't track as much, didn't look at those targets as well, showed more learning problems than the children with autism who did. So then we had a nice connection between this measure of public speaking and tracking avatars and learning problems in children with autism. Not only that, we found that when we used the fade condition, the children with autism would show more attention to all of the avatars. So we know that this method can be used to change how much or how often they're looking at people. So it becomes a paradigm that we can use for intervention as well. We found something unexpected, though. I'm going to show you one child. This is just one child with autism as they're tracking. Remember, they're talking. And so if you're talking to a group of people, I'm not looking like this when I'm talking to you, and I'm not looking down here. I'm looking right along the horizontal plane. That's where you are. So that's the task demand, is to keep looking back and forth just like that in this particular task. Oh, come back. So this is one child with autism, and he's looking to the right, but he's going way above, a little bit above, now way above the avatars. And now he's coming back down. Whoa, that's not quite the right angle. And now he comes back to the right angle, but loses it again. So some children with autism, we discovered, had poor head control in this particular task. And that part of their tracking problem wasn't simply a ocular tracking problem, it was actually a motor problem. And we found something even more interesting. Younger children, these are just the children without autism, showed those kinds of problems, but older kids didn't. So it was like the motor tracking system for some of the children was less mature, some of the children with autism. That's a completely new finding, and we're able to see it because we can actually look at the child's perspective while they're engaged in communication in virtual reality. So it really gave us a lot of information. It's not only an intervention tool, but it tells us more about children than we can otherwise typically see. I want to tell you about one more task and then go on to Tony Simon's work. So one of the things that children with autism don't do is this. They don't spontaneously share and look back. They're not so interested in having people pay attention to what they're interested in. And that creates all sorts of learning problems because being interested in getting people's attention on what you're doing helps you get information about what you're doing. Now, that's a very prominent measure in working with preschool children, that type of measure of the child trying to gain attention to something they're interested in is part of the diagnosis of autism. But we don't have any measures of that for older children once they get into school. So Gwan Guk Kim, working with me, decided to develop a measure of that. And here we have another virtual paradigm where the child is watching. They're sitting here, they're watching the avatar, and then pictures appear, and the avatar shifts their attention, and the child studies that picture in one condition. They're following the gaze of the avatar. In another one, though, the child chooses which picture to look at, and the avatar follows their attention. Now, in that condition, the avatar is acting like a real person, and they're following the child's attention. There's reason to believe that this has a different effect on how well you process information than this does. And so in this particular paradigm, I told you that before there was this tracker up here, it's a little gyroscope. Now we actually have an eye tracker in the virtual reality monitor itself that's tracking the child's eyes. So we can see what happens when the child shifts their gaze and the avatar follows the child. It's a very interactive and very precise type of virtual reality. What we found, we did this with undergraduates, and we found that when the avatar would track the child's attention, or the young adult's attention, they remembered more picture than when they followed the avatar. The young adults would remember more pictures than when they followed the avatar, indicating that having the avatar follow their attention impacted their learning and their information processing. And then we did that with a group of children with and without autism. And this was the first study of children with this type of paradigm. And we saw that children as young as 8 to 16 showed that same effect. They remembered more pictures when the avatar followed their attention than when they followed somebody else's attention, the avatar. We saw that with children who had a lot of symptoms of ADHD, but we didn't see that at all with the children with ASD. We saw that the children with ASD showed no difference between when the avatar followed them and when they followed the avatar's gaze. So there was a big difference here between ADHD children and ASD and typical children in ASD. Now you notice when they're following the gaze of the avatar, everybody's showing the same ability to remember pictures. So it wasn't just a memory problem, it's the effect of having their attention followed. Now think about what happens in a classroom. Teachers come up and say, oh, you're doing really well there, John. I like the way that you're doing that. For most children, that has a strong impact on their learning. There's a literature out there that says that children with autism aren't so responsive to that. That's a problem for them. This coincides with that. We can actually see some of the mechanism using virtual reality. So that gives you just a sense of one component of this gaming virtual reality work that we're doing here. I want to shift gears now and pretend that I'm Tony Simon and talk about something a little bit different, but not terribly different. And I'm right on time. I just got a signal saying that I was right on time, so that's good. So I'm going to play a video because the video will give you the outline of what Tony's doing, and then I'm going to fill in the gaps.
I hope that he is able to get the funding to make it a bigger video game. It would just be so great to have something that can help, but that isn't hard.
The problem we're trying to address with the technology here is that we have a lot of evidence that several kinds of neurodevelopmental disorders generate problems in the mind and brain of children and adults who are affected. That makes it very difficult for them to mentally represent information about space and about time. I often use the analogy to a digital camera. It's like having a low resolution digital camera where some of the information is missing. So when you try to sort of zoom in and make a distinction between two small things, you don't have access to the information anymore. That makes it very difficult to learn some very basic and very important functional skills in life, like thinking about numbers about time, about money, learning arithmetic, very important things that you need to function.
Well, Caleb is 7 years old, and he has 22q deletion syndrome. It was diagnosed at birth, and he is an awesome little boy, loves baseball, loves his big sister, great kid. 22q deletion syndrome is caused by a deletion on the 22nd chromosome, and it happened new in Caleb, and it's caused him to have a number of different issues. He had open heart surgery when he was 3 weeks old and 6 weeks old, but he's always been a real trooper. He's done really well with all of it.
The reason that we went to a video game kind of approach is that it sort of became clear there was an evidence base emerging that young adult college kids who play first-person, generally shooter-style video games were actually showing increased capability of the same functionality that we were discovering that children with these neurodevelopmental disorders were impaired at. And so the question for me then became, what was the active compound in those kinds of games that we could extract out and make much more palatable games and much more targeted interventions for young kids with neurodevelopmental disorders? We built a prototype to see if we could turn those scientific ideas into something that looks and plays like a fun video game. Our first version only tried to make a game that adjusts to the player's spatial and temporal abilities because we needed to get that right before creating the game's active compound. In this version, we get kids to zap the energy out of ghosts that pop up at different speeds and distances around their little Ghostbuster avatar. Our early findings suggest that it's a fun game with positive impact on spatial attention. And we need to actually build a much more fully functional version of the game and then really engage in something that more resembles a clinical trial to see whether we can show that it has the effect that we believe it's supposed to have.
I would love for him to have as many opportunities as possible to, you know, gain cognitive function and to be healthy and thrive in the world that he's living in. And I feel like that's what the focus of the Mind Institute has been, is not just focusing on how it happened or why it happened, but they really do try to say, what now? What can we do now to improve the lives of these kids? And then he can go on to, you know, actually get benefit out of it. That would be awesome.
That was great.
All right.
So in that, you quickly saw that Tony's working on attention too. And when I was talking about the virtual reality, we're talking about children with autism having a huge array, not a huge array, an array of people around them, and being able to focus on the center, but not necessarily paying as much attention once they start going away from the center. Tony's talking about much the same thing with other children with problems. And not just, so he focuses on 22q, and 22q is a neurogenetic disorder that's associated with quite a few different problems, but one of the problems is an attention problem in many neurodevelopmental disorders. Attention problems are kind of at the core of a lot of different disorders. And certainly in 22q, but you also see it in Fragile X, Turner syndrome, nonverbal learning disabilities, and a lot of these attention disorders in this group of children affects their ability to manage spatial relations, temporal relationships, and fundamentally math skill development. So let's understand that a little bit better. When we're developing, our brains, you know, aren't able to really pay attention to the world in the way adults do. It gradually develops. Spatial and temporal information is really, really critical. And in these disorders, there's a problem there that I'm going to describe in just a second. Interestingly, we see this is a problem here, but it's also a problem in aging. It's a kind of parallel problem between the neurodevelopmental disorders and what happens to our spatial and temporal sense when we're aging. So right now, I want to give you a sense of what this is really like. I want you to focus right there. Focus your attention right there. And tell me how many bars you see to the right of that X. Yeah, I mean, what most people see there is four bars, right? But there's actually five bars there. And it's because peripherally we lose our ability to discriminate spatial and temporal, spatial information visually. And for some people with neurodevelopmental disorders, that's even much worse. So looking at this X, you'd see three bars there, or you wouldn't be able to answer the question at all because it would be completely fuzzy. That's the perceptual problem and information processing problem that Tony's working on. And particularly with 22q children, you can see the way you measure this, as you know, in a really clever way, is to have children look at that dot, and then another dot will appear in this matrix. And that's first level is 10 degrees, 20 degrees, and 30 degrees away from the central fixation point. And kids with 22q have a really hard time. They're worse even on the central, but they get much worse as you go out to 30 degrees. Their span of attention can't capture the information as well. Now that's really important for a number of things, but as infants are developing, you have to have this kind of broad span in order to become sensitive to differences in numbers of things. This is called numerosity, and infants aren't born with the capacity to see differences in numbers. But if you have this spatial problem, this numerosity detection system doesn't develop as well, and it leads to problems in math development. Now here's another one that I want you to look at. So imagine you're driving down the road and your fixation point is right there. Look at that fixation point, and how many children do you see that you could possibly run into? You see, probably you just see this one. There's another child right there, but as soon as you fixate there, your spatial perception gets to the point where it can't register that. Now that's the same sort of thing that happens to many of us as we're getting older. The integrity of that spatial span of processing information begins to narrow, and over time, we start to have more and more problems between 60 and 90. We just start to lose some of that, particularly when we start dividing our attention. When we're really focused, not so bad, but when we start to divide attention, it's a little bit worse. So Tony's work spans neurodevelopmental disorders through to aging in terms of trying to figure out the role that this particular ability is playing and how to remediate it. So he's developed FastBrain a lot with a lot of other people. And FastBrain uses the advantage of video games. In the video, Tony said that first-person shooter games really have a positive impact because they train children, adolescents, adults, to broaden their span of spatial processing in order to do better. So just exposure to those games tends to do that, but you can make the games much, much better. And that's what FastBrain is. FastBrain is a very targeted method to enable children to play a game that will actually expand their perceptual field so that they can process information on the periphery. And that should, theoretically, actively activate the numerosity system or help that develop in many of these children, potentially affecting their math development. But where the data are right now, so here's a child with 22q who comes in, and this is a measure of how well they're doing in terms of 10 degrees, 20 degrees, 30 degrees of perception. And when they come in, you know, 10 degrees is okay, but they do really poorly out here at 20 and 30 degrees. And really this method is only supposed to increase perception out to 20 degrees, but after clinical trials, this one child did much better. This other child, when they came in, they showed this kind of okay and then a drop off at 30 degrees, but after the clinical trials, they did much better out to 20 degrees, but then it didn't affect them at 30 degrees. This is the kind of honest data that you have to see, and this is why this is really important. These methods don't work with everyone. Tony's working on this, and he's seeing enough of this kind of effect to say it really works for some, and it partially works with others, but you've got to see this over hundreds of kids in order to know that your method works, and he's moving in that direction. These are an 80-year-old and an 83-year-old who are presented with this, And this 80-year-old was doing very good in terms of perceiving out to 10 degrees and 20 degrees, so there wasn't much impact on them. But look at this out here, at 30 degrees, this person increased dramatically after playing the game. Now here's an 83-year-old who wasn't doing so well even at 10 and 20 degrees, but they improved dramatically at 10 and 20 degrees after playing the game, but not much of an effect out here because they were really having more problems there. So again, very honest data, not completely helping, but helping enough to suggest that this is a very important new method to pursue. And so the two together give you a sense of going after attention mechanisms in autism and in a variety of neurodevelopmental disorders, and even attention mechanisms that affect us all as we age, and trying to bring these new technologies to bear in a very informed and targeted fashion to try to change the course of development, improve the course of development for us all as we're aging, but for children with neurodevelopmental disorders, to stop a problem that is developing over time. Okay? So now I'd like to switch gears again a little bit. And one of the great things about being at UC Davis is really good students come to you and say, can I work at UC Davis? And Matt was one of these. We have developed an academic development program in the School of Education. It was about reading at first, but Matt came in and said it should be about writing as well. And he was right, and he's going to talk about that.
So part of this, and it was actually funny hearing the talk from the other presentations on Grand Theft Auto and Call of Duty, because this really came to idea of working with children and really trying to go after their interests. And I floated the idea a little bit of trying to do like a Call of Duty writing assessment type of thing and realized that wouldn't go through IRB and there'd be a lot of other issues, so I went with Minecraft instead. But as Peter mentioned, I'm Matt. I'm a doctoral candidate within education. I've had the fortune of working with Dr. Mundy and other colleagues now for 4 years here through the longitudinal study with the virtual reality work and also more recently with the Reading and Academic Development Center. But today I get to talk. Probably one of my favorite parts of grad school was developing this kind of Minecraft writing task. And through today, we're going to talk a lot about video games, a lot about Minecraft, and then a lot about the Minecraft writing assessment. And so a Navi is up there. If you play Legend of Zelda, it's kind of like a, hey, this is important type of thing. So, but I also want to say before we get into video games that it takes a whole village of people to really make everything happen. And Peter mentioned a number of people, but I also wanted to extend that to the current team at the Reading Academic Development Center, pictured in numerous things where they learn never to trust me with Photoshop for holiday cards. But includes within this project, Dr. Mundy, as well as Nancy, Lindsay, Jamie, Hillary, Tasha, and numerous undergrads who both helped code and helped run the research. And numerous new colleagues now at the Reading Academic Development Center, such as Emily Solari, who is the director, as well as Alyssa and numerous other grad students, and our team of 30-plus undergrads who I could spend the rest of the time just saying all of their names. So that's just to say, this has been a lot of fun, but it's also been a lot of fun working with a number of people involved as well. So video games. Video games have a growing recognition within kind of academic and educational interventions and looking at social and cognitive and other academic development areas. And so really in taking Minecraft and putting it in an educational setting is really nothing new. And especially within video games, there's a growing amount of literature on the use within typical developing kids and within kids with neurodevelopmental differences. And they offer sites where we can really study the way of how humans interact with video games in these different settings and contexts that can sometimes not even feel like a task a lot of the time. But why do we study video games? And so Squire in 2011, who's a well-known researcher within the area of video games, put forth kind of four broad reasons that I just wanted to echo at the very beginning here. Is really the first one, developing academic interests. I was a history major in undergrad because I played a lot of Age of Empires, and I love Age of Empires, and now I'm here instead, so who knows? It's fun playing them. It's more fun using them in research purposes too and watching kids play them so much better than you ever could. They deeply engage those who play them, opening doors to really manipulate and think about different design issues. They allow for participatory educational experiences. I taught a Minecraft summer camp this last summer, and I lesson planned for the first day, And I'm so glad I did not be on that, because as soon as that first hour was done, I realized these kids know so much more than I ever will, and they would be bored if I just planned everything out. So it was a lot of fun. And they're aesthetically enlivening experiences that really are kind of a lot of kids these days are playing video games over the last few decades. So that brings me to Minecraft. So who's heard of Minecraft before? Good. That's very representative, because it's actually sold over 106 million units since 2009. I know, I got in the wrong field. So, but it's a, if you've not heard of Minecraft before, it is a sandbox construction game that's really open world. An easy way to think about it is 3D Legos. And so rather than having to trip over and stub your toe and break every little thing in the house whenever you step on it, instead you can just sit down in front of the computer and play with zombies and skeletons and the Ender Dragon and all kinds of fun things. You can also farm, and you can interact with the game world and with different villagers and different people within it as well. It's a whole number of things you can really manipulate and do in a single player environment and a multiplayer environment. You can build simple houses, more impressive ones, entire fantasy cities. I'm usually just at the top left one. There's a reason why I study this and not play it a lot. You can learn about logic gates, and actually there's whole programs dedicated to looking into physics and computer programming within Minecraft. Kids during the summer loved making TNT cannons and seeing how high they could explode themselves, usually about 6,000 to 7,000 feet in the air, and then it'd blow up and they try again. You can use redstone, which is a specific type of ore within the program, to create your own switches. And people have actually built functioning supercomputers that can do actual mathematical equations and have working memory and hard drive space that are all just a function of blocks. And again, people are really smart and have developed a number of different modifications or mods to even grow the experience further. And so these are just a couple of the ones that some of the summer kids loved. Pixelmon, which basically puts Pokemon into Minecraft. This summer with Pokemon Go and this at the same time was just Pokemon Overload. There's a different survival mod, Star Wars, roller coasters, and these are all made by people who play Minecraft and are supported by other kids, and great ways to actually learn other ways of programming within Minecraft too. But all that comes back into Minecraft within an educational component. And the Minecraft Education Edition was around for a while and was actually just revamped a few months ago when Microsoft purchased Minecraft from Mojang. And it's a platform really to make Minecraft more user-friendly for teachers and for use within the classroom. And so it allows a lot easier way to manipulate it, even if you have no idea what you're doing from a coding perspective or from a Minecraft perspective. And so I just wanted to highlight a couple key things. You know, it allows for easy classroom collaboration and allowing students to collaborate with one another on the same server within the same classroom space. So you could have 30 students all playing together on the same one, doing specific tasks together. You can control kind of what they can do, what they can destroy. They'll still try to blow everything up because that's usually how it goes, but they have fun with it. There's non-player player characters, so you can interact with a number of different people. There's different ways of collecting data through taking pictures, through actually storyboarding and actually using the screenshots as a way of learning both inside and outside of the game. Different chalkboards, which is their way of kind of saying a way for the teacher to give information to their students directly in the game. So you don't have to say, write it up on a whiteboard and tell students, okay, get out of the game and do this. You can embed it right into the experience. And there's tutorial worlds, because as popular as Minecraft is, some kids still have not played it. And some kids have played it for hours and hours on end. Some kids have heard of it and never played it before. So there's ways of all people to really get involved with it. And I wanted to highlight as well, just there are lesson plans out there that are designed by teachers and designed by educators as ways to really think about how to use Minecraft in these different settings. So you might be aware of Minecraft, but not know how to actually do what you want to do. Well, as there are with mods, someone's usually beat you to it and has usually come up with a great idea on how to do something like that. So one that I wanted to highlight here was actually a lesson plan on empathy education within Minecraft. And this was developed for 8 to 18-year-olds. It's indexed by a number of different tags on, say, service learning, social goods, social-emotional health, technology, and builds skills and character, creativity, critical thinking, and lays out everything really nicely for the teacher, for the parent, for the educator, for whoever wants to use this for their kids. So there are different learning objectives. There are different guiding ideas that kind of guide what these lessons would look like. There's very explicit student activities. There's performance expectations so that you can also help to know, like, what should my child be doing? My child's doing this. Is that good? Is that bad? Is that something I need to fix? Is that something that they shouldn't be allowed to do within that paradigm? And there's a number of different references as well. So it's really easy for a number of parents, educators, and even kids to really engage with Minecraft beyond just sitting down and blowing up sheep, which is still fun. But all this is to say that interesting, innovative lesson plans don't always translate into evidence-based or research-based instruction or investigations. And so there's a number of great ideas and lesson plans out there, but I wanted to shift gears a little bit and talk about how Minecraft has been used so far within research settings. And to think about a game now that's been out since 2009, so about 8 years almost of research, there's a growing but not a huge amount of research yet. This is just a quick scan through Academic Search Complete, which is an online electronic journal database. Found about 21 articles. Found about almost 100,000 for video games. So we're still, you know, it's a small subset of the video game literature, but a growing subset in that. And I want to talk about two specific studies. One that was more of a lit review that kind of overviewed how has Minecraft been used within educational settings. And another one that was in a classroom instruction intervention. So this one, these researchers found that really Minecraft has been used to study topics in geometry, sustainable planning, language and literacy, digital storytelling, social skills, informatics, computer art applications, and chemistry. You could have an entire school curriculum just based within Minecraft. And there are schools out there interested in stuff like that. There's growing interest for developing tools in ecology, geology, biology, physics, geography, arts, history, media, artificial intelligence. Harkening back to virtual reality, they've also investigated using virtual reality paradigms within Minecraft because it sets itself up for a really nice immersive 3D world that you can then manipulate further with modifications or with different edits. And recent work has also really tried to play around with that single player versus multiplayer aspect and kind of the different ways that kids engage with the video game and are interested in learning more about the video game. Up in the top right, what that is showcasing is actually the same bridge through two different views. The one on the left is a collaboration view, and it actually shows which user built what parts of the bridge. So you can actually better understand how kids work together to design and build something within the video game to get a better understanding of engagement and collaboration in real time, rather than, say, at the end of it, going back and trying to figure out who built what. Because kids always tell the truth, right? And again, there's been a number of key benefits for using Minecraft in educational purposes. You know, blocks are able to be placed and manipulated really easily. If you don't like a world, you can just make a new one. It's also a one-time fee, so you're not paying hundreds and hundreds of dollars for various little pieces here or there. There's different biomes that can be used for ecological purposes and different ways of studying science within the state standards. It activates a whole bunch of knowledge on construction and collaboration and just very simple ways of engaging with it. It's all blocks. There's nothing intricate about it until you start trying to build something more intricate. So the learning level to actually engage with it is really easy, but then it becomes really complicated. You're not gonna be building a supercomputer your first time playing, but who knows? Maybe a year down the road, maybe watching some YouTube videos, you'll figure out what to do. So the second one I wanted to look at was an in-classroom study that they looked at the role of Minecraft in educational learning environments. And they looked at Minecraft in two different contexts. They looked at an after-school club, and they looked at an in-school classroom. And so the students in both settings were excited to use Minecraft and actually experienced very little difficulties in navigating the game. You can ask Dr. Mundy about his first time navigating the game, and his story may or may not be the same as that. About 72% of students believed that there were educational benefits to using Minecraft in the classroom. Like, all of a sudden, you have kids thinking that they're already going to be getting benefits out of it. You have buy-in a little bit from the students, more so than you might of other non-Minecraft or video game methods. But there were some differences in perceptions. And so it's a little bit small up there, but on the left was more so within the classroom, whereas the club was on the right. So within the class, They were concerned about negative play. They were concerned about so-called griefing or destroying each other's property. Whereas within the club, they were not at all concerned about it. They were there to have fun and enjoy it, so it was a very different dynamic. Within the classroom, they did not use the text in Minecraft. They actually talked outside of the classroom versus in the club. They used the text within the game to communicate. So already there's a number of different things that you might want to investigate or think about rather than just, say, throwing Minecraft into the classroom. But again, these are things that need to be further researched and studied to better understand what their role is. So in thinking about the learning potentials, a limited number of students mentioned the actual architectural aspects. So when we think of Minecraft, we usually think of building. We think of creating all these giant things. Like I showed you the pictures of different cities and towns and whole worlds. But they actually talked more about collaboration and problem solving, critical thinking, and creativity. And if you ask any teacher, that's really what you almost want to see from your students. There was high student engagement with the learning tasks. The students actually didn't ask the teacher for technical help. This teacher instead acted as a facilitator within this paradigm. But there were still some key distinctions. So again, there were players and non-players within the two demographics. And to really understand the differences of those is going to take a lot more research. But this was about neurodevelopmental disorders. And so I want to kind of harken back into that aspect of the work now before we get into the writing assessment stuff, into what Minecraft, what else is available for Minecraft in autism specifically. In 2013, there was actually a Minecraft server that was created by a father with autism and his son who also had autism called Autcraft. And it started as a small little idea and has since ballooned into a 7,000 member community where families actually have a 3-week waiting period to even apply to get onto the server to then play with other families of adults and of children with autism as a very kind of either safe and collaborative environment. They hold server meetings and events and all kinds of different things as a way to bring engagement and to foster social communication across the kids as well. So there was a researcher just this last year who spent 60 hours in this world to try to figure out a little bit more into what was actually going on. And her key findings so far were that families combed through all the discussions of the online forums. They took in online forums, YouTube videos, they wanted to know more, and they made use of that information to try to better understand how to use Minecraft in this sense. The families built friendships and had fun together. So there was collaboration not only within families, but across families. You know, 7,000 members in this community, that's a huge. And kids expressed feelings, joy, sadness, anxiety to both in-game and real-world problems. So anecdotally, they were seeing these changes in kind of the social-emotional components that, again, needs further studying to really understand the potential here. But now we get to my favorite part. If you ask anyone, asking me to talk about video games and writing is a very, very, very dangerous thing. But it's going to be fun. So we know so far that Minecraft can be a potentially beneficial learning tool that children from a variety of backgrounds have found rewarding. We know children often enjoy playing and using and manipulating Minecraft in different ways. We know Minecraft has been used to study educational outcomes in school-age children. So I put a book up here called I Hate to Write, which is focused on tips for helping students with high-functioning autism to write. You might say that kids with autism don't necessarily like to write, and that's kind of the prevailing notion within the literature. So I wanted to know, could Minecraft be used to help us understand more about these writing abilities and strengths and weaknesses of school-age kids with autism, rather than more so a standardized sit down and take this test type of approach. So a very quick backstory within writing and autism. So from the literature, we know that children with autism often write less complex texts compared to typically developing peers. We found within a longitudinal study just this last year that children with autism with higher ADHD symptomatology, so meaning that they're more at risk for attention concerns on top of autism, have shown decreased performance on more of the thematic and organizational components of writing compared to typically developing peers, and still exhibit a number of word production difficulties present in other kids with autism without ADHD, or just kids with ADHD with no autism present. And we know that there's a growing interest in evidence-based practices to understanding how to intervene in these writing difficulties, but we don't have enough research yet to really know what's useful, what's beneficial, what can teachers and educators and researchers do. So I put this up here just to kind of make a sense of writing is a very complex cognitive social skill. And there's actually a number of different social and cognitive factors that go into writing when you sit down to do it, whether it goes from the control level of thinking down into sitting down and thinking, what is my goal, what is my task, what am I trying to accomplish when I am trying to do this, how quickly can I get away from this writing experience sometimes. At the process level of actually how are you navigating trying to think about all these different ideas and then put it down into paper. And at the resource level, you're trying to think about attention, you're trying to think about what are you looking at, what are you trying to read, what types of things do you have to keep in mind. So there's a number of different processes involved in learning how to write and writing well. And a lot within the writing research in autism actually has not focused on these different processes. A lot of it has actually focused on just how are the kids writing? Are they writing a lot or not a lot? And so we have a paper under submission right now looking actually how can we better understand the writing difficulties in kids with autism from this theoretical model. And in designing this task, this was kind of the model I had in mind in thinking about what different things could you manipulate within a writing task, especially when there's a motivational aspect involved. So to develop this, we needed a measure. We needed to measure children's knowledge and engagement with Minecraft. We needed to demonstrate the writing ability in relation to something Minecraft related. We needed to consider multiple options for writing skills from that diagram I just showed you. And so in the context of this, this comes from the third time point of a longitudinal study, of which Dr. Mundy is the PI, for school-age children with and investigating social, cognitive, and academic abilities in kids with autism and kids with ADHD. And this was by far the most fun, pending my dissertation, part of grad school so far. This is not my dissertation stuff, but I almost wish it was at this point. What we designed first was this Minecraft background knowledge questionnaire. So it was a way to really get at what are the different ways kids engage and familiarize themselves with Minecraft. Again, we had about 160 kids and a whole range of ages from 8 years old to 16 years old that we needed a way to quantify and think about how are these kids engaging with it. So almost as a way to explore the ways of them engaging with it, because I knew that they knew way more than I ever could about this. So we asked them a number of questions about their familiarity, about the systems they played on, about how they play the game, who they play the game with, and they were asked 8 content-related questions too. So I want you guys to take just a minute. You can use the piece of paper that was handed out and just think about A, B, C, or D for each of these. This is testing your Minecraft knowledge. So the first question is, what is the main character's name? Second one is, which animal is not in Minecraft? Sugarcane best grows next to what? What do you need to make a crafting table? What type of ore can you find in Minecraft? What type of tool do you need to make a farm? Which enemy is not found at night? And what type of ore is rare and found deepest underground? Everyone get 100%? Pretty good? Check your answers. Good? Okay. Remember what you said, and remember these questions, because I'm going to show you in just a little bit how the kids responded to this. So after that, we needed to actually have them engage with Minecraft. And as much fun as it would have been to have the kids play and engage in different ways, that was the crux of it. We didn't want them to necessarily engage in different ways. We wanted them each to have the same type of task and to write about the same type of task. So what you're seeing here is a video that took like 6 times of recording over and over and over again that the kids watched for 2 minutes. And it's 2 minutes of Minecraft gameplay when the main character goes down from a house, walks through a village. You're going to go see him jump into some water in a second, go swim with a squid, jump back out, go back into the town. He's going to trade with a villager. He's going to go kill a sheep, because that's what you do in Minecraft, get some wool, get some mutton, and then he's going to go off into a cave. And from this, the kids were then asked to recall, after watching this, as much as they could remember about it. You'll see on the right here a list of all the different items that they could have remembered. This was a standardized list as a way of trying to capture the different things they might remember. Anyone catch the red flower in the doorway? Some of the kids did. And in doing this, what the kids were also given at this point was, so the experimenter took this all down onto a list, onto a tablet. And this would come back to help the kids when they were asked to do the writing prompt. So that the kids were then asked, your task now is to write a story about what happened in the video you just watched. So you're writing your story to someone your own age who knows very little about Minecraft and has never played Minecraft before. So there are a couple of important points here. One that I forgot to mention was that they could either handwrite or type it. So we're manipulating their preference to how they want to respond. If they're a stronger handwriter, if they're a stronger typer, that's their preference. Second point is they're writing to someone who knows very little about Minecraft. So remember, we have that questionnaire now of how much they know. So we can now start to look at how much does the child know versus how much does their audience know. And we also now know that this person has never played Minecraft before. So again, this kind of component of this person knows nothing and has never played it. So how much detail should the student provide? What type of story should the child write? There's a number of different questions to ask here. I wanted to leave it open to really get a sense at what types of responses do we get in a more kind of non-standardized task. So I want to share just a little bit of the preliminary results as we have about a few minutes left. And there's a whole bunch of different numbers and graphs. Ignore those, and I'll just kind of say the main kind of takeaways from all of this. Again, this is very preliminary. There's a lot of data to still try to figure out, but this is kind of the first look into it. And so we saw that very few children had never heard of Minecraft before, and few had never played it before. You can see that in the far left one, the know nothing about Minecraft, less than 5%. Only 3%, and I think that's the autism group, one person out of 133 had never heard of Minecraft before. Majority across all the other categories at least had some experience with it, usually between 75 and 86%. So in all, a really familiar sample with Minecraft. They had demonstrated a high degree of familiarity across different types of apps and versions of Minecraft, a number playing on the computer, on the iOS or the app or the phone, game consoles, and about half of each group had played at least one version, about a quarter had played at least two versions, and about a fifth had played all three versions. I wonder when these kids go to school, that's a whole other question, but there's a lot of Minecraft. It was very varied, actually, on how kids played. Some kids played by themselves, some kids played with friends. Interestingly, you know, children with autism reported the highest percentage of playing by themselves, while children with typical development reported the highest for playing with others. Again, something that might be more worthwhile to look into to really kind of see these social communication and kind of these friendship concerns within the broader autism literature and how that might be mapping into how kids engage and play with Minecraft in this setting. Minecraft-related media, again, children across demonstrated varying degrees with, again, very low percentages, kind of overall about 20 to 40%, but that's engagement in either reading and participating in forums, that's downloading mods and textures, like about a quarter, except for about almost half of kids with ADHD have done that. Creating and designing new textures, not as many, but that's a more difficult task to do. And watching YouTube videos, again, about almost a half in kids with ASD and ADHD had done that, but only about a fifth in typically developing kids. Again, interesting questions to consider further. Kids blew the content questions away, for the most part. So almost about 80% did really well on the first four. So if you didn't know what the main character's name was, what animal's not in Minecraft, sugarcane best grows next to what, or what do you need to make a crafting table, these kids may know a little bit more than you do. Interestingly, we see a high performance across the different groups that's very similar, except when you get down to this last one, this what type of ore is rare and found deepest underground. That again, we see kids with typical development actually answering correct at a higher percentage than kids with autism or ADHD, which again warrants a little bit further investigation into. So just a few more things and then we're all done. For that video recall, so remember this was the task where they were then to say back as much as they could about the video they just saw. We saw across most of the subcategories that there were no group differences, except for three. In each of these three groups, kids with autism were the lowest compared to kids with typical development. And so it's, again, not that they weren't remembering anything, it's that they were remembering a lower amount of items compared to kids with typical development at the beginning, when they were at the water, and a total number of items recalled. And then when we get to the writing, unfortunately, I do not have the writing sample analyses for you because analyzing 140 writing samples takes a little long, but they're really cool. So look forward to next time. But instead, what I can offer are a couple of different things. On the left, you see the preference to handwrite, and you see kind of a group split between about a third of each group wanting to handwrite, while two-thirds wanted to type. Again, you see this very nice split across all the diagnostic groups. On the right, you see word count by diagnostic group. This is covaried with full-scale IQ because our kids with typical development were a little bit higher. But what that just means is that kids with autism were actually still performing, on average, lower than kids with typical development, meaning they were writing fewer words compared to kids with typical development, but not kids with ADHD. So again, we start seeing these group differences that we might think, is this similar to the past literature, different from it, and what types of new ideas and questions might come from looking at the samples in addition to just these word scores. So a couple quick concluding comments, and then we'll get to the Q&A. So video games in Minecraft offer learning environments rich for exploratory and intervention research on academic, social, and cognitive abilities in children with or without neurodevelopmental disorders. There's a rich research literature that we can really draw on in both educational and research paradigms to better understand how to use these within research settings, but also within educational settings too. And our preliminary results demonstrate how researchers might use Minecraft in educational or writing research and ways to really inform a video game area using kind of academic theories. As Peter was saying, really trying to understand what video games and how can you use the video games to really get at the questions being asked. They're extremely preliminary, and we are going to do a number of other analyses involving the writing samples to better understand all the different components. And it's also really interesting to note that children quickly become aware of become their own content area experts in various video games. They often play many more hours, and you're often telling them to get off of that computer or that Nintendo 64. I was there as a kid, same thing. That we really need to understand and use that to empower our own research design and educational practices, and to think about designing it not only from our perspective, but from what the kids are able to do as well, and what those outcomes and variables might be to really investigate further. So thank you all so much.
So we have a couple questions here. Let me start off with this one. Is there a difference among English language learning, EL, was that English language learning?
Yes.
Students with autism? I mean, I think that we don't know many things about students with autism, particularly that 5 to 18-year-old period. I don't think I've ever seen a study really on bilingualism or language fluency as it then goes on to impact children with autism. Given that children with autism have a vulnerability to difficulties with communication, you might imagine that it would amplify those to some degree. However, it's also possible that the bilingualism eventually, as it does for many children, actually helps in some ways down the line for some children. But it's a great question without a very clear answer, I'm afraid, at this point in time.
There's another part on this one. Is that close enough? All right. There's a question on does Autcraft help? And did they know they had to write after playing? So two separate questions. So on the does Autcraft help? As I said, there's only been a really preliminary amount of research on it so far. And unfortunately, that's a lot to say within a lot more of the outcomes within the Minecraft literature. I think there's a lot of great ideas. And I think there's a need for a lot more rigorous understanding from a number of different research areas, both from clinical and developmental researchers, as well as educational researchers, to get at what might be helping, what might be the components of Autcraft that we could then duplicate within the classroom or within other communities, and if we can't, what's really special about that community or those collaborations across the families. So I can't answer that for sure, but I can say hopefully within 5 to 10 years, there'll be researchers who are really diving into it, like the one that I mentioned there. And I'm happy to also send the whole reference to that one as well if anyone wants to know more about that study. The question on the did they know they had to write after playing, they did. And it was actually fascinating. So we joked a lot within the longitudinal study that we did not need an anxiety measure because we had writing measures. And it proved true for the first two time points. As soon as you said, oh, you're going to do some writing, they're like, oh, about Minecraft. Minecraft? Okay, I'll do that. And it was like, and we had another task at the same time that was a narrative-based task that was definitely not as enthusiastic. And that's a question that I want to explore further within. We have video data on these kids as well while they were writing, and this initial interaction to this kind of how they reacted to this notion of needing to write, and then the content that they were even asked to write about. This idea of trying to fight against even engaging with the task, which we have a number of kids who just refused to write for some of the tasks. But as soon as you mentioned Minecraft, we had no kids refuse. We had a lot of variation across how many words they wrote, but no kids outright refused. And they loved the videos. It was the funniest thing to watch them get super close to these videos and really give the experimenters a run for their own working memory as they tried to write down every little detail that they remembered from the videos.
So one of the questions is a kind of deep question. Are you or the work that we're doing assuming that perceptual changing the perceptual systems of people will translate into critical thinking or changing how they're thinking, I guess at a conceptual level. Am I getting that question right? So the idea here, the short answer is no. I mean, this would not translate into critical thinking because these are cognitive and learning mechanisms that are actually not part of that higher order thinking. They're the ways that children are taking in information. So many of the learning problems that children have, like reading disability or math disability, are perceiving the parts of sounds of speech or numerosity. And the idea is that those don't develop well. But they are probably still plastic and malleable. So both the work on the virtual reality measures and Tony Simon's work is to try to go in and take advantage of that plasticity, which I showed you at the beginning, provide a lot of trials that are a lot of fun to engage in that will help develop that perceptual information processing system that then allows other things to happen. But it's sort of a gateway, a learning gateway, that if it's there and functioning pretty well, you can go on and learn other things more easily. But if it's not functioning very well, it makes it really hard to go on and learn things more easily, like critical thinking in math, for example. Is that a clear enough answer?
Yeah. And I think one thing to note also within writing, and a huge component for the writing task, was again this avoidance. And I think the knowledge and the competency within Minecraft and knowing that, you know, that might translate really well into writing about it. That might not. If they can, those writing skills there may not then translate or generalize over to other writing not involving Minecraft, especially for kids who may have a fixated interest on video games or other similar tasks. And so really thinking about how do you help facilitate that. If you're able to see this motivational aspect be a really core component to them engaging with it, can you then use that as kind of a part and help them generalize those skills into other academic domains that don't involve that? And I laugh whenever I hear, you know, oh, kids with autism hate to write. I've worked with K through 12 undergrads and grad students. Everyone hates to write. Kids with autism are no different in that sense. But we have different ways of going about it and different skills we develop to get through it. And so a lot of this research is also really trying to focus in on how do we help kids develop those motivational skills or the self-regulation skills to really engage and get through it.
For kids whose visual attention increases after using Fast Brain, was there also improvement in numerosity? That's a great question. It's one of the next questions in his program of research. The first step is to demonstrate that the new program is actually addressing the target. And he's fairly far down the road with that. The next step is a clinical trial where you do it with a lot of children to see if it works with 40%, 60%, 100%. And then you also take the step of saying, okay, now if we can get this going, Does it impact numerosity, and then does that impact math skills? That's a pretty complicated chain, though. First, you have a lot of practice with developing the wider span of attention. How long do you need to do that before it starts to affect numerosity? We don't know. And then how long after you develop numerosity can we then move over and allow this learning mechanism to open up the gateway to a higher order learning process of math? But that's the plan, and the plan should unfold, you know, fairly quickly at this point.
Before I read this question, I like to say the answer is yes, because it would help me a lot to understand kind of how I made it into grad school. And the question is, do you know if strategic games like Pokemon or puzzle games like Legend of Zelda might have an effect on cognitive development? And I say yes, because both of those were my childhood growing up. So those are both near and dear to my heart. And I think the question here to ask is, do we, you know, in non-video games, do we think that strategy or puzzle games improve cognitive development in general? And that might be the starting question to ask. Unfortunately, I'm primarily a writing researcher and not as much within the video game literature. I know the Minecraft area really well, but I don't know the Legend of Zelda and Pokemon areas as well. I've tried convincing Peter for me to study that, but that was a long shot. But I think there's a lot to be known within there, and I think there's a lot, if it hasn't been rigorously researched already, a lot of opportunities to really engage and think about both the ways we believe kids are engaging with them, and then really understanding how the kids themselves engage with it. As I mentioned, when I was working this last summer through the School of Ed and taught 7 weeks of Minecraft learning summer camps, I had to completely rethink everything because I approached the camps as if I was the instructor facilitating and teaching them something. But I immediately learned that we needed to tap all of their knowledge to actually get a better sense of what they could learn out of it. So I easily see a similar thing here. I mean, thinking of Legend of Zelda, I think of a lot of speed runs, I think of glitches, I think of ways that people have manipulated and changed the game so drastically that to ask them to just complete a dungeon within a certain amount of time might tell you something, but instead to ask them, oh, how did you warp past 2 hours of gameplay might tell you something more. Similarly with Pokemon, you could ask them about different types of the game, but you could also ask them how many items do they just duplicate with missing no. If you don't know what that is, go look it up, it's a lot of fun. But there's a lot of rich questions to get at that might help us better understand kind of these components, especially within the educational side.
One question is, how do I participate in research here? And there are pieces of information out on the desk that you can grab that will direct you, but you can also go to the Mind Institute website, and it will take you right to Tony Simon's research or over to the Reading and Academic Development Center or any number of other research groups here where you will find more information about how to make yourself known to a research group and participate in the research. So I hope that's clear. Here's a question that's a tough one. Do you have any materials available for a 90-year-old driver that would inform them about the likely reduction of their field of view where trying to persuade a family member to stop driving? Unfortunately, you've gone way beyond my expertise. I think Tony's working with the Alzheimer's group here on applications of his research to that question. And I think the thing to do would, again, be to go to the website, Tony Simon, and try to communicate directly with him. I'm just not expert enough to deal with that.
I have a fun one here that I could spend hours upon hours talking about, but do I have broader guesses about how Minecraft can help in education research or education in general? And I want to tackle that from a couple different perspectives. And one is that's from the teacher kind of professional development perspective, because you can have kids who know as much as they can about Minecraft, but if you have the teacher who doesn't value that knowledge within the classroom, you're all of a sudden shutting all of that out. And so one component would really to be thinking about different ways interested teachers at first definitely might have either heard about Minecraft for education or might think about ways of adopting it within their classroom, using those lesson plans and trying to go through that whole process. It is a process because learning those lesson plans might just be similar to learning other non-Minecraft related lesson plans. There might be more technical language involved that might completely shut them down from it as well. There's a lot of research there to be done to see what are the obstacles on the teacher side as well as the child side of implementing this type of research. The other component here is then on the child side, and a lot within the family side as well. There's a number, you know, there's a number of things to be said about limiting screen time and limiting kind of the amount of video games that kids play, especially if it's impeding other areas of development and functioning, or sleeping or eating or going outside or any of those typical things. That turned out okay. But to really think about how can it be done in a learning way and a way to really help build these social and cognitive skills. One of my first jobs when I was in high school was at an after-school video game daycare. And I was there for 4 years, and it was so much fun. And I was working with these two junior high kids who both had dyslexia ran in their family. And their parents were very concerned, and these kids would not read. They just did not enjoy reading. But they loved these couple of video games that that were more of like an MMO, like a massive multiplayer online game, that had a lot of text-based quests. So I sat down with them and sat down with the parents, and we read through those quests, and we actually used those that text as a way to work on reading skills within the game, as a kind of reward that then once they knew what they were doing, they could go on and do it, but they had to show either me or their parents that they were able to also do that. So it was a learning opportunity embedded with the game, not within an educational game, but within a game that could be used for educational purposes in that regard. So I think there's, you know, a lot of stuff to be said about thinking both about educational games, but also games that may not be first thought of as educational games, and really exploring it from a multitude of perspectives, which there have already been a number of researchers who have done so within kind of the video game and learning literature as well.
This is a question with regard to Tony's work. The question really is numerosity and peripheral vision, that it wasn't clear how those two things are connected, and the follow-up question is, do you know how improved peripheral vision helps with numerosity? This is a great question because it means I wasn't clear enough with regard to Tony's work. So we're not really talking about peripheral vision, we're talking about attention. And the ability to attend to something, your peripheral vision could be absolutely fine and still not be able to attend to something that's 30 degrees outside of where you're foveating. It's not your retina, it's not the peripheral vision that's doing that. It's a slightly higher level of visual processing that's involved here. So it's not really peripheral vision. It's attention, and it's the ability to allow your attention to expand. The reason that that's really important at a young age in infants, they have to be able to gradually expand their attention so that when they look at different things in the environment, they can see the number of them, the numerosity. And so I showed you a little bit of one test. You have a panel that has two dots and a panel that has eight dots. That test is, how fast can you tell me how many are in both panels? Well, everybody can go two. A three-year-old can go two. But when it comes to seven, it takes longer for a child to do that than it does for an adult, because as we get older, our attention system improves so that we can really perceive that as a gestalt, as a whole. That's what's not happening for many of these neurodevelopmental disorders. They're not perceiving the total number because they can't expand their attention to take in the entire amount of the number, the different elements in the number. And so what Tony's doing is trying to get that attention system, practice it. And you know, the practice is, these kids are there and they have a way to, you know, kind of shoot this ghost. And at first, the ghost is appearing right in front of them. But then all of a sudden, it's appearing out here, and then out here. And it's how rapidly can they detect that. It encouraged that attentional expansion. But it doesn't have much to do with peripheral vision. So I hope that clarifies that a little bit. Just one other question, at least for the moment, is we're going to have a little bit of a discussion. So what do you suggest for the over 30 people with autism. Suggest in terms of something specific like writing or attention, can a little bit more maybe on that if that person's still here?
Social skills.
Oh, in terms of...
Do the games work for social skills?
You know, I think that we don't know because this is such a new area, but I think what Matt was talking about in terms of Minecraft, there's a lot of opportunity within both the web-based facilities and these video games to encourage collaborative activity that's enjoyable, interactive activity that's enjoyable. So there's at least a reason to believe that some of those things might be helpful. But when we get down to evidence where I can say to you, we know that X is helpful, we don't know that yet, unfortunately.
Okay, so Peter's winning about 9-4, so.
Tony Simon's
cards. Okay, I'm winning about 4 cards to now. I think a question I just got was, are kids with ASD versus ADHD more or less competitive? I'm gonna interpret that within kind of the gaming context. I don't know that literature as well. I think it'd be something really interesting to look at, especially within this notion of collaboration within these games. I can speak from anecdotal experience from this last summer. These were not kids with, these were not necessarily specifically kids with neurodevelopmental differences. However, there were a number and a range of different ages, of different groups, and of different levels of competitiveness, different levels of you can blow up this much stuff before I'm sick of you, and different levels of that kid is no longer playing within this group. I only had to shut down the server a couple of times. But it was an interesting mix, I think, within this to think about, not necessarily if one group is more competitive than the other, but necessarily on the individual differences side, does that impact how these kids may form collaborations or even more of attacks in certain ways within these games? And I say attacks because there are combative games that are actually the goal of the game. A number of the games that they were playing were either different kind of battles or kind of fighting simulators within Minecraft where you're kind of gearing up and then duking it out. So it's kind of collaborative and building up to that, but then it's every person for themselves. And I think there's different skills involved within the different components that it'd be really interesting to look further into how are those different kind of individual differences really impacting that online environment. I know within a related area within more of the MMO, there's been a lot of research on World of Warcraft and different kind of gaming groups and different kind of social structures within larger MMORPGs, which is massive multiplayer online role-playing games that have now had a decade plus of research that would be probably really open to thinking and answering questions on, say, competitive natures of different gamers and how that impedes or impacts kind of the game plan that. But I can't necessarily say for sure within that.
So there was another question on the same card, and it's a little hard to read. I think I've got it, though. Is it known how VR and video games result in improvements in people with ASD, and then there, or I couldn't quite read the rest of that, but, sorry?
The
elders. So yes and no. This is still a new field, but let me give you an example with children with autism. So we do a lot of social skills groups for children with autism here at the Mind Institute and elsewhere. And the social skills approach is to say, we can talk and practice in a group different skills that are important. And let me use paying attention to people's eyes, because where they're looking and how they're reacting with their eyes while you're talking can tell you something about how well you're communicating or what the topic is that we're communicating about. And we can have children practice that in the social skills, and we can help them develop rules. You know, what do you do when you're talking? Well, you look at people and why, because it helps you understand if they're paying attention or if the topic has shifted. But with social skills groups, we can do that for an hour a week or 3 times, 20 minutes a week or some amount of time. But when we're doing that in interaction with other people in a classroom or elsewhere, it has to be really fast. If you have to think about it and then do it, you're often too slow to keep up with the social interaction because it's not automatic for you. So the how of why video games, all of these things, not necessarily the writing, but certainly what Tony's working on and what we were working on with the virtual reality, is to give children a platform that's enjoyable where they can practice enough so that it becomes fast. Because with certain things, perception or social interaction, you can't use rule-bound, top-down regulation to do it in an adaptive fashion. It has to become automatic and fast. And so the video games allow a child to practice enough and enjoy it enough to practice enough in order to take what they're getting in social skills, for example, and do so many trials that they can become fast at it. I mean, that's really the how of it.
I know we're just about out of time, but I wanted to fight back on the writing side real fast. Because one thing that I think of course, you know, like a Call of Duty writing simulator is not gonna sell all that well. But I think of a lot of narrative and story-based games, and especially the storytelling that happens within games, as a way of really teaching narrative structure and of possibly using that to help kids as well think about what are the different components of writing, what are the different components of writing different types of tasks, and using almost the video game structure to work on that speed and that generation aspect of it, because we're still testing a lot of kids within a timed writing assessment component, which, for better or for worse, puts a lot of cognitive load and a lot of stress onto kids apart from the writing itself. And so I think within kind of the video game aspect, especially if you have the motivation and the interest engagement side of it, it can be a very rewarding, reinforcing way to start to think about different genre structures and different ways of getting at what is good writing in different components. You know, if you were to necessarily read, you know, if a Call of Duty game sounded all of a sudden like some other kind of puzzle game, or like Tetris all of a sudden, you'd feel a little bit weird. It'd kind of be weird all of a sudden like shooting blocks. But who knows, maybe it's fun as well. And it's a way to kind of mix across different things and help that the ability to kind of think across those different domains too.
The UC Davis Mind Institute was created in 1998 with a promise to find cures for neurodevelopmental disorders. Every day, our physicians and researchers come closer to fulfilling that promise. Their groundbreaking research on autism, Fragile X syndrome, chromosome 22q11.2 deletion syndrome, ADHD, and other brain disorders are helping children achieve their fullest potential. Please visit our website to find out more about current studies, upcoming events, and how you can help make a difference.